the harbor in the US, and he moved back to the, his country, where he's actually a professor and the director of the Institute for Stem Cells and Human Genetics. His research is focusing on stem cells, human genetics, and cancer. He's a member of the most most committed associations about stem cells, editor in the more prestigious stem cell-related magazines, and he also gives testimony about the issues of human embryonic stem cells before the U.S. Senate and the European Union. Nissim?
Thank you. It's really a pleasure to be here, and thank you for the kind introduction. I will tell you today about the human haploid embryonic stem cells, how we derive them and what we are doing with them. Before that, I think that all of you know how amazing are pluripotent stem cells, because they can differentiate all cell types. You can really study what is pluripotency, and I will touch them at the end of my presentation. There are issues regarding regenerative medicine. It's becoming more and more popular to use embryonic stem cells and also IPS cells in the clinic. The issue of toxicology, because there are embryonic cells, you can really study teratogenicity. And disease modeling as well, you can do with different strategies. And in the past 20 years, we are working on human embryonic stem cells and human-induced pluripotent stem cells, studying all of those aspects. But today I would like to talk with you about a different type of embryonic stem cells, and those are haploid embryonic stem cells. So when you're thinking about ploidy, which is the number of sets of chromosomes that you have in your body or in an organism, clearly they are haploid organisms like this. Although most organisms, including humans, are diploid, but there are organisms, there are triploid, tetraploid, hexaploid, octoploid, and even more. And they are mostly different vegetables and foods. So during lunch, when you're eating your food salad, which is great for you, you can try to calculate the average ploidy of your what you eat, because most of them are not diploid. So humans are diploid, but there are tissues or cells in our body that are polyploid. So clearly, the placenta is polyploid, megakaryocytes are polyploid, can reach to 64N, but also Golgi cells, hepatocytes, muscle cells, and more. So you can function even when you are not diploid. You can have polyploidy. But the only cells in our body that are haploid are sperm and egg. And in order for them to become diploid, they must merge, have a fertilization. And then from two haploid cells, you are getting the diploid cell. And from a haploid egg, you cannot have more haploid eggs. They do not divide. And from a haploid sperm, you cannot have more haploid sperms. So for many, many years, it was thought that haploidy, especially in humans, is a dead end. If you're haploid, you cannot divide. As I show you, this is not the case. You can proliferate, you can differentiate, I'll show you as a haploid. But before I'm showing you that, I would like to show you a short movie sequence, less than 3 minutes, that my university made for educational purposes on human pluripotent stem cells, and then I'll go deep into this.
The cells in our body contain genetic information in the form of DNA. This DNA is packaged into 23 pairs of chromosomes, making a total of 46 chromosomes. One set of 23 chromosomes is inherited from the mother, and the other set is inherited from the father. Cells with two sets of chromosomes are called diploid cells, and they can divide to generate more diploid cells. Reproductive cells, the egg and the sperm, are the only exceptions that contain just one set of chromosomes and are called haploid cells. However, egg and sperm cannot divide to make more of their own, and during fertilization of the egg by the sperm, they generate a new diploid cell, a new type of stem cell that carries only 23 chromosomes. The discovery of human cells capable of cell division with just one copy of their genome was reported in the prestigious journal Nature. The scientists were able to start with haploid human eggs and use them to generate human embryonic stem cells with half of the genome. Human embryonic stem cells are the holy grail of stem cells, as they can turn into any cell in our body. And amazingly, the haploid embryonic stem cells could become brain cells, heart muscle cells, gut cells, and more, with only a one set of chromosomes. This new type of human stem cells will have a profound impact on human genetic and medical research. Haploid human cells provide a novel tool to better understand human development and the reason why we reproduce sexually instead of from a single parent. A huge advantage of haploid human cells is that it is much easier to edit their genes. In diploid cells, detecting the biological effects of a single copy mutation is difficult because the other copy is normal and serves as backup. The researchers were able to show that by virtue of having just a single copy to target, haploid human cells constitute a powerful tool for genetic screens. Being able to affect single copy genes in haploid human stem cells will greatly facilitate genetic analysis in biomedical fields such as cancer therapy and regenerative medicine. Human embryonic stem cells hold an enormous promise for cell-based therapies because of their potential to make any cell in the body. Since the haploid embryonic stem cells have only half the genetic diversity, they can serve as a better genetic match in transplantation medicine and may also be suitable for reproductive purposes. The research was mainly supported by the New York Stem Cell Foundation and by the Esmerelli Foundation.
So basically, I told you that the haploid egg cannot make more haploid cells, the eggs, but it can divide. It can divide while differentiating into an early embryo instead of making more eggs. And in the past, it was thought that when it's dividing before dividing, it will really duplicate the genome to become a diploid cell. But this is not the case. As I will show you, at the early stages of development, if you are starting with a haploid egg, the cells, most of them, will stay haploid. And only later on, some of the cells are becoming diploid. Eventually, in culture, all of them will become diploid. But if you look at early stages of their derivation, you can find some haploid cells among the diploid cells. And for those, we really isolated the pure population of haploid cells. So in order to show that what we have are haploid and we almost have cells, we showed it by four different methodologies. I will briefly go over these methodologies because I'll come back to them later on. So basically, you can do that by fast analysis, DNA content. So the diploid cells will have either two copies or four copies in G2M. While the haploid cells will have either one copy in G1 and two C in G2M. By color type, it's clear that what we got is haploid cells versus the diploid cells. We can look at that also by DNA fish, looking at two different chromosomes. In diploid cells, you have two spots from each, while in the haploid cells, you have only one spot of each. And by centromere staining, this is a methodology that we established during our work, that in the diploid cells you will have 46 dots, while in the haploid cells we show that they have only 23 chromosomes. So basically, they have a normal karyotype, haploid karyotype, and we did a copy number variation, the normal, we did also exome sequencing to show they are absolutely normal. So in many respects, they look like the diploid cells. So by morphology, this is the characteristic morphology of the colony of human embryonic stem cells. And the haploid looking very, very similar. They are stained with the same markers. They express the same surface markers. The 60 is one of them. They express the same genes characteristic genes for human embryonic stem cells, like OCT4, NOD, and so on. But we want to look what are the differences between haploid and diploid cells. So we looked at RNA stack, or genome RNA stack, DNA methylation, and we measured the total RNA and the cell size. So basically, when you look at the cell size, as expected, the haploid cells are about half the volume of a diploid cell. They express about half of the RNA, and we think that they also express about half of the protein. So when we look at their transcriptome, the haploid cells and the diploid cells are very, very similar. Almost all the genes have the same expression in the haploid and the diploid cells. And basically, only when we look at X chromosome, then the expression of the haploid cells diverge from the expression in the diploid cell. And the reason is very, very simple for that. In the diploid cells, we have two X chromosomes. One of them is inactivated. So if you look at the autosomes, you have two copies and both of them are active. In the X chromosome, you have two copies and one of them is inactive. While in the haploid cells, you have one copy of each and the X chromosome are active. So if you are looking at the level of expression in the haploid cells, so the level of expression in all the chromosomes is about half than the diploid cells. Only at the X chromosome, it's about the same, because there's only one X chromosome in both them, and that is active in both of them. So if you are looking at the ratio of X chromosome versus autosomes, it's different between haploid and diploid cells. I told you that by the transcriptome, they look very, very similar. But there was one pathway that they look different, and this is C2-T3 formulation. It was higher in the haploid cells. It was higher, as you know, C2-T3 formulation occurs in the mitochondria, and the genes that encode for the mitochondrial genes, enzymes, are coming either from the mitochondria or from the nucleus. So we look at the nuclear genes that are making the different parts of the oxidative formulation complex, and they are higher, the expression is higher in the haploid versus the diploid cells, and also in the mitochondria, the expression is relatively higher than in the diploid cells. Eventually, when we look at the number of mitochondria, actually the level of mitochondrial DNA, it's higher, it's relatively higher in the haploid cells than the diploid cells. So what we see is that relatively we have more mitochondria. So relatively we have more oxidative phosphorylation. The reason for that, maybe we can discuss later. So basically, surprisingly, the haploid cells and the diploid cells look very, very similar in the transcriptome, and you can hardly distinguish between them. And the reason is that if you look at the haploid, it's about half the volume. Half of the RNA, half of the protein. So the concentration of the proteins in both cells are the same. So in essence, they look very similar. But still, when you are looking at the level, at the ratio of surface area versus volume, volume is R to the third, and surface is R to the second. So the surface area versus the volume is higher in the haploid cells. They have relatively more mitochondria, so the ratio of mitochondrial DNA versus nuclear DNA is higher. And because you don't have Nissim activation in these cells, the ratio of X linked expression versus autosomes is higher. But in essence, they are very similar. So I showed you that we have haploid embryonic stem cells, and they really said to you and proliferate, but what about differentiation? Can we differentiate them? Can we differentiate them into haploid somatic cells? Those are these somatic cells can proliferate. So in order to do that, to look at that, we look at individual differentiation, either by embryo bodies, this is kind of a complex of different cell types together, or by looking at the strain we are generating. Neural cells, myocytes, and pancreatic cells by direct differentiation. And in vivo, we look at spontaneous differentiation in the thermocouple. So I'll start with the embryo bodies. By morphology, they look very similar. Still, most of the cells in the embryonic bodies for haploid cells are still haploid, either by the haplotype or by FAPS. Every time that I'm now going to show you somatic haploid cells, I'm going to show you by two different methodologies. And then we took the 1C cells, the cells that are purely haploid, and we looked at their transcriptome. And again, they are expressing brain markers, skin markers, muscle markers, and you can find really very clear markers for different tissues, like keratin, myelin, lamin, albumin, surfactant. And they are differentiated in the same way as liquid cells, still as haploid. Then we look at direct differentiation. So from the ectoderm, we show the neural differentiation, in the beginning neural progenitor cells, again haploid. We took the 1C cells, and by RNA-seq, we show that they are, the haploid cells are expressing all the markers of neural progenitor cells. Then we differentiate them into neurons, Th1 positive cells. Again, we can find by central staining that we have haploid neurons, and by DNA fish, also we can have haploid neurons expressing having only one chromosome. For each of the organisms. We move to the mesoderm, so we differentiate them into cardiomyocytes. I don't know if you can see, they are beating cardiomyocytes, so we can have haploid cells that are cardiomyocytes, again by FAPS, they are 1C. We took these 1C cells, stained them for troponin 2, and many of them are positive, and also by cellular staining, they are positive. They are haploid and expressing troponin. What about the endoderm? So there, differentiating them, beginning to definitive endoderm, again having haploid cells. Then we went along and differentiate them into pancreatic progenitor cells. And again, these haploid cells expressing PDX1, also NDX6.1. And we looked at the PDX1 positive cells, and many of them are still haploid. We could also went ahead and differentiate them into beta cells, and they are also haploid. But these cells, when they are haploid, when they proliferate, they are becoming diploid. So during differentiation, because they proliferate, they are also becoming diploid. So I showed you that you can have haploid cells without X inactivation, without inactivation of chromosome X. So that was for the undifferentiated cells. Now, in the embryo bodies, we show also that the differentiated cells also having, do not have X inactivation, they do not express cysts, and they express the X chromosome. High levels as haploid cells. What about differentiation in vivo? So first of all, we could show that the human embryonic stem cells, we have two lines of haploid cells, differentiate into ectoderm, mesoderm, and endoderm in vivo, having the markers of ectoderm, mesoderm, and endoderm cells. But maybe more importantly, we could show that these teratomas, some of them have very high percentage of haploid cells. Analysis and also by DNA fish. So this is a section into the teratoma. What you see here is a primitive gut, and this primitive gut by DNA fish are still haploid because they have only one of their chromosomes. So in the past, it was so that if you are haploid, you are incompatible of having the somatic cell identity. You cannot proliferate. Cells that do not have dosage in balance, meaning that they inactivated one of the X chromosomes, it their female cells cannot stay as somatic cells. But this is not the case. Haploid cells can differentiate to all lineages that we looked at. They can readily proliferate, also as haploid somatic cells, and they can survive even with dosage imbalance. They don't care that they are haploid and readily differentiated. I told them that there are very few differences between haploid and diploid, but there is one important difference that we are studying, we don't understand it completely. So the haploid cells are becoming diploid. There are two ways to become diploid. One of them is by cell fusion, and the other is endoreplication. Endoreplication meaning that they duplicate their genome S phase, but then at the end phase, instead of dividing, they are going back to G1 and duplicating their genome again. And these cells are becoming diploid because of endoreplication. The rate is quite high. Between 3 to 9% of the cells in each cell cycle will become diploid. So if you are growing them for about a month, you have to sort them again for haploid cells, and then you have a population. So that occurs very frequently in haploid cells. While the diploid cells, some of them can become haploid, but it's very, very rare. So why the haploid cells tend to become diploid is something that is studied in them. One other issue with these cells is their use as for genetic screening. And the idea is very simple. If you are diploid, and you are making a mutation in one allele, the other allele is a backup. But if you are haploid, then it's much easier to do loss of function screening. And in the beginning, we showed that by a gene lab, and we looked for resistance to 6-tiergluamine, which is a kind of classical selection. And what is known about 6-tiergluamine is that if you have a mutation in HPRT, you are resistant. It is known because HPRT is an X on X chromosome. So male cells have only one X chromosome. So if it's mutated, there are resistance to 6-tiergluamine. But it's very difficult to find this kind of mutations in autosomes because you only have two copies. But because we have haploid cells, we can identify another gene, NUD5, which is part also of the nucleotide metabolism, and this is an autosome. So that was kind of a proof concept for the genetic screening. I'll show you more about the genetic screening later on. So basically, we could show that we can derive the cells, we can differentiate them, and we recently published a protocol on how to grow them to the right end, and we are giving away the cells. So if you want to use them to study haploidy or genetic screening, as I'll show you in a minute, you are welcome to get them. So regarding evolution, so basically, haploidy exists in nature, as I told you, in unicellular organisms. Clearly, the yeast can be haploid uniquely, but also in invertebrates, you can find haploidy. All the male ants and all the male bees are haploid. The female are diploid. The male are haploid. So you can have a normal haploid formation as a haploid. And the male bees, although they are haploid, they are about the same size as the queen. So you don't see a difference there. In mammals or in vertebrates, you don't find haploidy in nature. You can do it experimentally. It has been shown that in the fish, you can have haploid embryos, but you don't have haploid adults. In rodents, you can have in mouse and in the rat haploid embryonic stem cells, but in the beginning, it was difficult to differentiate them into somatic cells. But we kind of completed the family, the evolutionary tree, and we have haploid human embryonic stem cells, and they're ready to differentiate into haploid somatic cells. So if you can have somatic cells. Why aren't we hungry? Why don't we have hungry human beings? So, as I showed you, there are differences between hungry and pickling cells regarding mitochondria and X chromosome, but those are mostly quantitative, not qualitative differences. The main reason why we are not hungry, because in humans, like in most mammals, there is genetic imprinting. So most of the genes in our genome are expressed from both alleles, but there are genes between the genes that are expressed either from the maternal allele or the paternal allele. So if you have only one set of chromosomes, it will be either maternal or paternal. You cannot have both if you have only one set of chromosomes. So you are missing expression of some of the individual genes. So that's why we can have any embryos that can be maybe happily if they are not particularly, but they will not survive eventually. So just to summarize this section, we showed that we can derive the embryonic stem cells. We showed four different methodologies to characterize them. We showed the high similarity to pickled cells, although we showed the differences in the cell side, as chromosome and specific formulation. And it's surprising for us, very surprising data, that they can really differentiate into somatic cells. So what we can do with these cells? So basically, we are studying them for developmental biology reasons. We are studying activation, or imprinting, and what is the happening somatic cell, and the neuroprotection. But maybe we can use them also for reproductive medicine. And the idea is that if you want to make embryonic stem cells can make all the tissues. It's more difficult to make gametes or germ cells. You can do it in the mouse, but it's really difficult there. In human, you cannot do it yet. But one of the problems of making gametes that you should go from diploid to haploid. You should go over meiosis. And this is very difficult to do in culture, not in people. But if you are starting with a haploid cell, you don't need to go into meiosis in order to end with a haploid gamete. And we can discuss that in a minute. Regarding the regenerative medicine, we think that it is less of an application for these cells, but in essence, they have only one locus of HLA, so they have less diversity, so it's really easier to match between the donor and the patient. But maybe the most important reason of using these cells is for genetic screening, and I discussed that quickly. We can do that by gene prep, and I'll show you from the rest of the presentation how we do it with CRISPR-Cas. And you can do it for different reasons. You can do positive selection, from mutating all the genes in the human genome and showing which mutation allowing resistance to chemotherapy or drug toxicity. And then only the cells that survive are the genes that you are interested in. But you can also do negative selection. So if you are looking at essential genes, if the yellow gene is essential and now it's mutated, you lose it in the culture. So by looking what is missing, negative selection, you can identify the essential genes. And then you can do it also to study biological pathway and blood modeling. Now we have time to discuss that. So basically, that's what we wanted to do, and we wanted to study pluripotency in the beginning. And we know a lot about pluripotency, and this is really amazing how one cell can make all the cells in our body. What is essential for this cell? We know many of the transcription factors, are the only one that are needed for pluripotency. So we try to address the issue, what is essential to become a pluripotent cell? To do that, we generated a very, very large library. It's currently the largest library using the CRISPR-Cas. We got it from the Broad Institute, all of this guideline. So we used 180,000 guideline to target all the coding genes in the human genome, with over 18,000 genes. So for each gene, we have 10 different guidelines. So it's a very robust screening, because if you are looking for, you think that a specific gene is involved, you're not looking for one mutation, you're looking at 10 different independent mutations. And doing that, we grow the cells, and we're looking actually what genes, when they are taking over, let's say the red genes, and which one are leaving, the green one. So we are looking for essential and the one that are in. We did it for about a month, and we actually were looking at the distribution, which genes, this is characterizing different genes, which genes are now depleted, those are essential genes. And which clones are enriched. If a clone is enriched, the gene that is mutated is growth restricting. Because if you are mutating a growth restricting, the cell will grow better. So we are looking for the genes that are essential and are important for proliferation, and we are looking for the genes that restrict growth. And basically, we could show, as a, again, as a proof of concept, we are looking at FOX4, and the cells that have a mutation in FOX4 are now depleted very rapidly, while the genes next to that are not. And again, PRBM14 is one of the markers for a pluripotent cells. It is depleted while the genes next to that are not. So basically, we have kind of score. It's called CRISPR score. What it means, it's very simple. We are looking at the abundance of each gene. How many cells do we find at the end and in the beginning? If we find a lot then at the beginning, we are getting, by the log 2, positive scores. They are enriched. If we are getting negative scores, it's depleted. So statistically, by looking at FDR, we would say that about 9% of the genes are significantly depleted. 9% of the genes in the genome, in the human genome are essential. While about 5% are enriched, meaning they are resistant. So what is called the listing about that? We were looking for the chromosomal location of the depleted and the output over. Also, the enriched genes, and then I'll show you how we characterize them. First of all, what is cell essentiality, and I'll show you, especially, and I'll show you three different ways to study cell essentiality: compartment, which cell compartment they are. I'll show you how we analyze all autosomal recessive disorders, because we have mutations in all genes. You can, in one analysis, you can study all genetic disorders and the genomogenicity of cells. And eventually, I'll specifically show you what is needed by our study for a pluripotent endocrine cancer. So if we are looking at all the genes, the essential genes, the majority of them are looking up. More importantly, if we are now looking each compartment, let's say extracellular plasma membrane is in the outer, then in the inner we have nuclear and mitochondria, and in between we have cytoplasm, Golgi, and we are looking for what percentage of the genes that encode the proteins in each category are essential. So if you are looking, let's say, 100 genes that are expressed in extracellular, only 1% are essential. When we are looking at the same thing in nuclear, about 12% of the genes are essential. So we can see that there is kind of a bias. So if you are in an outer membrane, there is less essentiality. If you are in the nucleus, in the mitochondria, on average about 40% are essential. And in between, and it's different genes in each category, Golgi, cytoskeleton, cytosol, it's about 5 to 7% than our essential. So we now look at a different way. We look at enriched versus depleted, but I make it more simple. We are looking at inhibitory versus inducing. So if you are looking at inhibitory genes versus inducing genes, relatively, there are more in the extracellular. And if you are looking at inducing, there are more in the non-cellular mitochondria. Meaning that there are more inhibitory pathways in the outer membrane and more inducing pathways in the nucleus. I now move to the genetic disorders, and we study the autosomal recessive disorders. And if you are looking just at this distribution, so this is the CRISPR score. Those are the essential genes, negative scores. If you are looking at all, this is the blue line. The red line, you are looking at all autosomal recessive disorders that have developmental retardation. So how soon can you see this developmental retardation? So if you are looking at many different disorders, can you see this developmental retardation as early as the blastocyst, as 1 week? That's what we were looking for. And we could show that out of all of those genes that have developmental retardation, about 25% are affecting growth even at the blastocyst stage, even at the pluripotent cells. So for these disorders, you don't have to differentiate them in order to see this growth retardation. For about 75%, you have to differentiate them, and the growth retardation can be seen only when you differentiate. But that was, for us, very surprising that for about 25% of the these disorders, the growth retardation started very, very early on, probably 1 week or embryos, and I'm showing one example. This is Fanconi anemia. There are 15 reasons for Fanconi anemia, 15 different genes. All of them are showing growth retardation. While in tuberosclerosis is a disease where you have hyperplasia and hypertrophy. And there are type 1 and type 2. And in both of them, you can see excessive growth. The last issue regarding cell essentiality. If we are looking at all the oncogenes, many of them are essential, as expected. You mutate them, the cells will die. With tumor-suppressor genes, many of them, when you mutate them, the cells will go better, as expected. They are tumor-suppressor genes. You mutate them, the cells will go better. But surprisingly, there are a lot that are essential. And those, they are really growth-restricting. The ones that are growing much better are involved in apoptosis directly. But this one are involved in DNA damage. So these cells, if you mutate them, only then the cells will grow much less. But because they acquire mutation, after the mutation, the cells will grow better. So the tumor is not because directly because they are mutated, but because they affect on other genes. So now I'm moving time to the last part of my presentation, which is what is pluripotency. And you can think about pluripotency in different ways. You can look at that from a developmental point of view, because in our body, the only time that we have truly pluripotent cells is when we are a blastocyst. So from the developmental point of view, the intercell mass is pluripotency. If you look at transcriptome, embryonic stem cells and iPS cells have specific genes that are expressed in them. So maybe the transcriptome is what is telling you to be pluripotent. The really amazing discovery of Shin and Yonaka was that you can reprogram somatic cells into pluripotent by a few factors. He showed four factors, and then he and others showed that you can have it only even with two factors, or four source two. So maybe pluripotency is what you need in order to convert a somatic cell into pluripotent. But we are trying to look at that from a different point of view. What are the essential genes that are needed in a cell to be pluripotent? which are genes that are not just expressed, but are really uniquely essential in this sense.
So basically, we could show again that most of the genes that are essential for human immune stem cells are nuclear, but we missed now the mitochondria. We don't find any mitochondrial gene that is essential just for the reward cells. But what we found is really, and maybe as expected, that we found a lot of genes that are involved in the transcription that are essential. The others are cell cycle and DNA repair. All of those genes that I showed you here are essential in human embryonic stem cells, and are expressed in human embryonic stem cells tenfold or higher than any other tissue. So they are very, very rich in human growing of cells and are essential. So although they are involved in very basic pathways of cell cycle and DNA repair, these genes are really important and uniquely expressed in these cells. So we looked at the transcription factor, and again, we find the genes that we expect, OCT4 and NOD-PRM14, but we found other members that we didn't expect. And when Yamanaka did his reprogramming, he did it because we knew of the involvement of OCT4, the NOD, and others. But now there are other genes that may be even better for reprogramming. So transcription factors are very important, but there are other transcription factors that are really, really reducing the proliferation of the recurrent cells. They are expressing in these cells, but eliminating, but reducing their expression. So we look, what are the differences between those two? So basically what we show, that all of those genes are expressed in human embryonic stem cells, but some of the genes continue to be expressed even when you start to differentiate the cells into embryo bodies. So the genes that are uniquely expressed in undifferentiated cells and start to be expressed upon differentiation, most of them are essential, while the others can be even growth restricted. So when we are looking at these genes, we try to see, okay, they are needed for embryonic stem cells, but all of them need for the same process. And which process is it? Is it differentiation? Do they stop differentiation of the cells? That's why they are essential. Do they regulate the cell cycle? Do they eliminate apoptosis? Why are they essential? So eventually, what I'm showing you here, that we studied four genes. All of them are highly expressed in pluripotent stem cells and not in other cell types, including transformed cells. And we looked why they are essential. And we look whether they are involved in differentiation, apoptosis, and cell cycle. To do that, we mutated each of them, and we did it either by guide RNA, CRISPR score, or knockdown by siRNA. We showed that now when we inhibit them, the cells will grow less. And we look by RNA-seq what is happening in these cells. And this is kind of a complicated story, but eventually we can show that some of them are really regulating differentiation, because when you eliminate them, the cells will differentiate. And some of them are really important for the metabolism of pluripotent stem cells, and some of them are really involved with the cell cycle. So if we are now looking at all of those genes, which pathways they are regulating, and these are the uniquely expressed, and many of them are uniquely essential. So again, we find kind of core pluripotency. This is the four, the log, and one we know. But we find a lot that are involved in protein and RNA metabolism. RNA splicing, protein utilization, genes that are expressed specifically and essential in these cells. We find, as I mentioned before, genes that are involved in chromatin organization and the cell cycle, and we also find a group of genes that are involved in metabolism, insulin signaling and phosphate modification. But when we try by string methodology to look whether there is a common regulator to all of them, we found eventually two different paths. One is what we call the pluripotency hub. And this is, we think it's really unique to pluripotent. This is the transcription factor, most of them are transcription factor that are really unique to these genes, to these cells. And here are a lot of genes that are connected and are involved in cell cycle. So when you are thinking about a stem cell, it should have a specific stage in development, but it should proliferate forever. So we think that these genes are allowing them to proliferate forever, while these are keeping them in their specific stage in differentiation. And we think that there are two regulators to these pathways. OCT4 is regulating most of the genes here, and E2F is regulating many of the genes. So we think that this is expressed in many cells, certainly in cancer, and this is unique to these cells, but the combination is not unique. So that was regarding the essential. What about the growth stage? So again, the cells that when they are mutated are enriched, they encode for growth restricting genes, because when they are mutated, the cells will grow better. So which genes are they? So as expected, maybe they are involved in cancer and BENVENISTY. BENVENISTY, out of the 18,000 genes, 53 was the gene that if you mutate that, the cells will grow the best. Again, maybe as expected. But 53 is regulating 13 different pathways. Which pathway is critical for human pluripotent stem cells? Do we need all pathways or a specific pathway? Because we mutated all of those genes, we can see which genes in this pathway mimic 53. And what we see is that this pathway is the most critical. If we mutate three of the downstream genes, we get the same phenotype as 53, and this is the IGF-1 mTOR pathway. So to show that, what we show that if we now treat the cells which IGF-1, they will grow better. We mutate and we inhibit mTOR pathway, they will grow less. And the reason why they grow better is because they have less apoptosis. It's not the regulation of cell cycle or differentiation. So maybe every cell, when we inhibit their mTOR, will grow better. It will grow less. And this is not the case. So mTOR is critical for embryonic stem cells. If you inhibit them, the cells are really dying. If you do it with fibroblast, and then we show that with lymphoblast, there is an effect, but not as much. With embryonic stem cells, they die in the just to summarize, we try to look whether it's mTOR1, mTOR2, it's actually both, but mTOR2 is even more important. I'm not going into all the details, but basically, we will show that mTOR pathway in somatic cells and in embryonic stem cells is a little bit different, and in embryonic stem cells, it's really involved in the mechanism pathway and not in the somatic cells. So we see that this critical pathway is unique to pluripotent stem cells. And based on that, we are trying to get a new medium to grow these cells. So if I'm just summarizing this part, we made an atlas of essential and growth of different genes and stem cells, we show a different aspect of cell essential and then pluripotent and neural stem cell essential, and also look at which genes are involved in both of them. At the end, we are now really involved in different parts. We are doing cancer research using these cells. We made a model for two different disorders in haploid cells, and we are looking which mutations will revert the pathological phenotype. So we expand. This is modeling use these cells, and we are also studying basic aspects of haploid cells. So part of this, especially first part of this research was done in collaboration with Peter Egli for Columbia University and US Cancer Foundation, an excellent PhD student and postdocs. He also did most of the work in derivation of algorithms in stem cells and neurocatalyzation, where Atikana Inmas, a postdoc in the lab, and Morty Terrence, and a PhD student in the lab, is a genetic information. Thank you.
Regulation in cancer and also polyploidization
in placenta, in megakaryocytes, so we're trying to do that using the process.
Very unique that
with such a big collaboration, but we saw that we have a chance to look at all the simulation and essentially.
Yes.
Yeah.
You said you mentioned that the haploid, the cellular, and the haploid, there are two mechanisms, hypofusular and replication. And this happens once, so we have the blood cells, and very few, and we begin to keep foreign.
Very, very rare. Very rare. We hardly see.
Do we know, maybe it's another question, but do we know what stops the cell from entering to keeping again?
We don't know that. Because there are cells in our body. I showed that there are different issues that can be polyploid.
Mm-hmm.
In most of them, it's endoplasmic replication. Mm-hmm. Placenta, megakaryocyte, side, liver, red replication. Muscle is in all these cells. So polyploid can happen in vivo, either endoplasmic replication, usually. In this endoplasmic replication, in the megakaryocytes, it's happening again, it can be 64-128. So as if there is no stop. In liver, it can get more than beta haploid, but it's rare. Why in our system, why normally cells do not behave like that, and they just duplicate the genome, and ours duplicate the genome once and not more than that? We don't know. We think that there's something unique about our haploid cells, that we think that the checkpoint is disrupted. So, as I told you, they are very, very similar. But we think that there, we didn't see it at the expression level. We don't know the basis for that. But that's what we see. And then, in the decoy, for some reason, they don't have this problem. But it's hand-breaking. We don't know the reason. Something that we are interested in, because, again, with cancer, they also have this ability to duplicate the gene, some of the cancers.
Just a very basic question. You only mentioned human cells, agriculture, mouse, haploid cells.
Yeah, so in mouse, now there are mouse haploid embryonic stem cells, red haploid embryonic stem cells, macaque, monkey haploid embryonic stem cells, and these are four organisms.
They cannot translate,
you mentioned.
Okay, the mouse.
The mouse, when they publish that, they publish, there are two books, beautiful book, but iPhone books, and by George Benninger, both of them published in mouse and embryonic stem cells, and both of them claim that they do not differentiate. Clearly, we show that they differentiate, and then recently there were three papers that show that they can differentiate the mouse cells. The reason why we think that they miss that, because the mouse cells are dividing more rapidly. So if you are dividing very rapidly, you become diploid. So if you are allowing them to become diploid, so you don't see the haploid cells. And that's why we see it. So the other studies, they really view haploid cells and they study them at early each step and they see that they are staying
haploid.
Excellent point. Okay. So let's say that we take the haploid cells and we put them in the blastocyst. Okay? So if they will stay haploid, we can have a haploid early embryo. It will be pathogenic, have only the maternal gene. But if early embryo, you can have it until mid gestation, you can have that. But they are becoming diploid all the time. So if we find the gene, the preventing form becomes diploid, and we put that in the mouse, we think that we'll be able to get haploid early embryo in the mouse. That's what we see. It's possible to get a haploid. But because they are dividing so fast and becoming diploid, we are missing that. We make haploid cells from an egg, so they are going in the maternal gene. Recently, I hope it will be published soon, we did it only for the maternal. We took an egg, we took out the nucleus, and we put a sperm. Now we have androgenetic, only the paternal. So we have diploid cells. Clearly, they started as haploid cells because they are homozygote, but we couldn't isolate the haploid cells yet. I think that we have enough lines. Some of them we will be able to get some haploid cells, and then we can divide them. We've seen by coming time a few metaphases, but we couldn't isolate them yet. So we can do it either with all maternal or all maternal.
Thank you very much.